Hi, good evening, everyone. So all the refractive surgeons in the hall, my seniors and colleagues would agree that the world of refractive surgery has expanded. We've come a really long way. And in the current scenario, promising 20/20 vision, or as we say, 6x6 in the Indian scenario, seems to be an act of instant karma. But I'm pretty sure that in the back of our heads, we all know that 20/20 vision is just not enough. Our patients are just not happy. They need more than that. But what else do we have to offer? I mean, we just, you know, the patient is reading all the lines in the Snellen chart and superb Snellen acuity. So with the collaboration with my mentor, we have accumulated all our experiences and our learnings from our unhappy pool of patients in the form of a video, Biomarkers of Happiness. So can we play the video?
Authors do not have any financial interest in the subject matter of this video. As a refractive surgeon, I have always wondered, what drives happiness in our patients? Something more than just disposing of glasses. What is that? What is the extra ingredient we need to add? Because clearly, in the current scenario, 20/20 is just not enough. The evidence lies in the increasing blocks, case reports of lawsuits from the unhappy pool of patients. So in our quest to find happiness, we tried to find the cause of dissatisfaction in each patient. As we explored, the more armed we became for the future, to generate more and more happier 2020s. By gathering the wisdom each unhappy patient gave us, we present Biomarkers of Happiness. This includes understanding the role of each aspect, ranging from ocular surface and tears, meibomian glands, corneal surface and optics, pupil, posterior segment, systemic factors, patient's personality. From tears to brain, each biomarker is derived from a real case scenario presented to our clinic. But how to approach this broad concept is through applying a simple cardinal rule of three, understanding the sequence of events which made the patient unhappy, journey till now. What are the possible causes classified under three key zones, patient personality, optics, and ocular surface, and interpreting the trend to be more armed for the future. Let's hear out the story of each bubble. The case of tears. Sequence of events. Glare post LASIK making the 25-year-old female unhappy. After multiple consultations, she was advised contact lens in view of irregular topography, but symptoms worsened, so she was advised topo-guided recorrection. But was the topography really causing glare? Then why didn't the contact lens help? We investigated to find normal pupil size, abrasion profile, and very severe contact lens intolerance in the past. So we got her ocular surface evaluated. She had low tear film breakup time, high OSDI score, and bad quality of ocular surface, all pointing to dysfunctional tear syndrome, which explained the glare. Based on our previous research, we did confocal analysis, which was conclusive of disturbed homeostasis. So what are the biomarkers of happiness in this case? Listening is the key here. As this case had contact lens intolerance prior to surgery, it's important to address and treat ocular surface inflammation pre and post-operatively. Such patients could do better with nerve-sparing surgeries. Case of meibography. 37-year-old female was referred to us with severe dry eye. She was extremely unhappy. Dry eye workup was suggestive of evaporative dry eye and treatment refractory to hot fomentation and lubricants. But why? Meibography scans showed high gland dropout. Such a simple missed pointer preoperatively created havoc in patient's life. The take-home message: preoperative meticulous dry eye workup offers preparedness against a lot of complications. Our next case: 4 weeks post-smile patient having blurring of vision. In an uneventful surgery, what could be the reason of unclear vision? Anterior segment OCT showed micro distortions in the Bowman's layer, explaining the blurring. A previous study is also suggestive of the same. Biomarkers of this case: even a 15 microns of Bowman's membrane can alter results. Intraoperative gap ironing enhances outcomes. Case of pupil. 2 year post LASIK patient unhappy due to excess glare, with regular topography and normal ocular surface. However, the mesopic pupil size was 7 mm, which was distorting diffraction and inducing higher order abrasions as the pupil size increased. Key points of this case. Treatment planning of ablation zone includes good judgment of patient profession and pupil size. Case of lens. Unhappy 40-year-old following refractive and recorrection surgery. We found internal higher order abrasions were dominant. Slit lamp examination and barometry did not show obvious changes, but we decided to wait. After 1 year, dysfunctional lens changes became obvious. This case brings out the role of lens optics, especially in the pre- and presbyopic age group. Let's look at our next case. Subnormal vision quality with pristine anterior and posterior segment examination. Vision metrics showed lower modulation transfer function. After an exhaustive workup in vein, where multifocal ERG showed subclinical maculopathy. Detailed retinal evaluation and preoperative vision quality metrics enhances outcomes. Another interesting case of a 22-year-old who came for better vision quality with LASIK surgery, but was found to have low contrast sensitivity. In collaboration with a physician, she was diagnosed as a case of multiple sclerosis. The biomarker from this case, systemic assessment cannot be overlooked. The case of the patient personality. 25-year-old male, very unhappy with remarkably normal scans and examination. On being unable to allocate the cause, we probed into preoperative expectations to discover that patient had history of anxiety, drug addiction. During the scans, there was fluctuating pupil diameter, accommodation spasm, fluctuating refraction with pupil diameter. In collaboration with a psychiatrist, the patient was started on treatment for his OCD. Literature also shows the effect of patient personality on pupil behavior. This case shows patient personality, which is one of the key factors to refractive surgery success. But is this the end? All our questions are not answered. To answer the unanswered, we reintroduce the concept of tears to brain, where the answers lie in our tears and can be unveiled by collaborating science and clinics. In collaboration with our Grow Research Lab, we started collecting tears in Schirmer strips and stored them in a biorepository, which were analyzed after sample aging. This started yielding our answers, tear cytokine levels related to severity of dry eye, post-LASIK ectasia. But the big question is, how do I take this knowledge to my clinic? Interpreting tear cytokine levels in the form of tear biomarker kit could be used for risk factor stratification and prognostication to assess outcomes in the future. So what really are the biomarkers? These are pieces of the puzzle which were all there, but put together to see the complete picture, and most importantly, connecting all the links to create happy 2020s and hence happy surgeons.
Thank you, Nimrata, for that wonderful video. So as Dr. Rohit had mentioned earlier, we would be having one psychiatrist with us to discuss few points how psychiatry can play a role in ophthalmology too. So we have a psychiatrist from NIMHANS over here. Dr. Vetish would introduce him.
Yeah, I'm really happy to introduce Dr. Shivanand Kattimani, who is an additional professor and who is here today with us to discuss about psychiatry in relation to ophthalmology. As we will be first posting a few questions, Dr. Nimrata would be posting a few questions on what she has noticed in her clinics on how psychiatry could influence her practice. And if we have other doubts, we can also take them in the same session. And I'd hand it over to Dr. Nimrata now. Thank you.
One of the biggest questions which everybody wants to ask you is, how do you refer to a psychiatrist? Minute we say psychiatry, then the big chain of event starts. What do you think we should say when you refer to a psychiatrist? Right, guys? Is that the biggest challenge? It's so easy to say, all of us know, all of us have at least 3 or 4 patients in a month who 100% we know we need psychiatric opinion.
They still consider a big stigma. I mean,
yes, it's a big stigma.
Yeah. I usually ask the patient to go out and speak to the attender and ask, make it come out from them. That, do you think it's psychological?
We'll ask him, how do you think we should refer to you? How do you want to increase your practice?
this is a good question. We're also trying to fight this stigma for many years. You know that human nature is very complex. When we meet ophthalmologists, we think that they are looking into our eyes only. And when you see any psychiatrist, you become very alert. That's why wherever I go,
for
I don't tell, reveal myself that I'm a psychiatrist. The instant you tell that you are a psychiatrist, they become very alert. And the nature you show outside is different from what you are actually really inside. The terms you can change. I work mainly in a government sector. The profile of cases that I see are different from what you see outside. Sometimes they might be highly demanding. They may not be satisfied with your services. And I really agree with you that the way you refer matters a lot.
See, I kind of moved out of psychiatry. I also did psychiatry for some time. And so I switched between both the sides. The way I understand the human mind is, if you want to refer a patient and you say your problem is mind and you're referring it to a psychiatrist, they hate you. You have to find a reason which is completely not logical in medical terms, and you refer to them, they like it. For example, you say it's hormonal, that's why your brain is creating problem, they like this. You say it's vitamin deficiency, they like it. You say it's because of some acute inflammatory changes, they like it. So what I do is I have to find in the blood test where something will be abnormal by small, which will show up as red. I highlight it and say, you know what, it looks like you have some issues with your mind, but you have to tell them that it is not the mind which has to be blamed. They like to be blamed something. So most of the problem, I think you will agree, sir, is psychiatrist patients have a tremendous amount of blame game. They blame something, and that's why this happened. The case which she presented, which we are co-managing with somebody from Punjab, is a very classic case. This gentleman had come to us, and he's a very senior surgeon, Dr. Grewal, because he said, this patient just complains that his problem has, the post-mild has made him so bad that he just cannot, his life is changed. So everywhere he goes, he has got a light colored eyes. The minute you go into, so you can actually see his pupil really big. So the ophthalmologist says, you know what, the problem is your pupil. And he gets more and more, because you're putting blame more on the surgery and everything. But when you start talking to him a little bit, which kind of we don't do it in a normal practice, there are two, three very interesting facts in it. And you have to listen to it very carefully. I think that's what she said. The one thing is, all my life, I was perfect. Means he looks like a model, and he wants him to look like perfect. And I got the surgery done, was only my glass was abnormal. So that point, you start asking more. What do you mean by being perfect? He said, I work out, I do this, I do that. I always believed that all my childhood, I cursed myself because I was wearing a glass, and I got a surgery done, and now there's a problem. Then, if you go probe deeper, a psychiatrist like him knows that your obsessive-compulsive disorder can be with your own self. So when you, and he was obsessive, and when you refer him to a psychiatrist, and I told him that, in his case, I told him very clearly there was nothing I could find fault. He was right, he was perfect. His blood test was normal and everything. When I referred to him, I said, you need him. I openly had to tell him that, you know, it's your mind which is playing the devil with the pupil. And you all agree there is no connection between the pupil and all that stuff, but you have to give some story. So I referred to him to a psychiatrist, and he has a severe psychological obsessive-compulsive disorder, which is so severe that she mentioned some grade, it's on the topmost grade, where mind is not able to reason that there is a problem which is not there, but he just wants to. The second part of this is, these people are heavy into drug abuse, because this guy has a very vague type of drug abuse where he mixes multiple types and mixes everything and he drinks. Or drink whatever, inhales, whatever form it's. And what is happening is the pupil itself, again, is not, and when we looked at it, the pupil actually becomes bigger with the substance he's using. So the second point, now you don't know which one to actually block. So am I right on this front?
No, this many interactions are there. First one is the personality, we don't come across that much. The second is the medication. I was hearing the discussion. Many of the psychotropics or antipsychotics, antidepressants can affect the refraction and vision and also can cause cataract. Not directly so, by altering the metabolic parameters like glucose intolerance, they can cause dyslipidemia, and by that change they can bring about vision changes. In OCPD, they cannot tolerate imperfection.
Yes.
They want a clear answer. When they go 3-4 people, they give a different opinion, they get more troubled. So if you have a clear listening time, if you give them more time, I think they'll be more satisfied.
But the question here is, I would like to ask Dr. Bellin, if you have a patient, how do you refer him to a psychiatrist like this, an obsessive compulsive disorder where people in your country accepted mental health as part of a physical health? How would you refer if you get this kind of a patient? What would you do?
Good question. Most of the time, especially in the US, they're already on medication and already seeing someone, which is really, it's not meant to be funny, it's actually true. Because that's what I alluded to earlier when they, I don't know if you're in the room or not, I said, one of the first things I do is I look at what the medication list, because most of them are on antidepressants or antipsychotics. It's unusual for me to see a patient with that type of relentless pain and discomfort who has not already seen some type of psychiatrist or psychologist. And I think it's more amenable, and at least it doesn't carry the same stigmata that is elsewhere. So like, referral isn't that really difficult.
Like Himanshu said, it's a big stigma out here. See, because what we had to do is the psychiatrist had to, there was no drugs for him. She had to wean him out of all this, explain to him, like what he rightly said is, you have to talk. Because if you really look at your practice, the people who are really unhappy with no reason and start asking them multiple questions, they have that OCD classical in them. Because obsessive compulsive disorder is the classic reason why they're unhappy with you. They can't tolerate dryness, they can't tolerate anything. Is there a questionnaire where, you know, give it to them outside without them knowing that you're analyzing them mentally?
Yeah, there are questions. Indirectly, you can identify that the person comes after a lot of consultation and brings a bunch of papers, meticulously documented each date-wise, whom he has seen. That instant you will know that it's going to be a trouble for you.
See, yeah. The reason is, I have a big problem with a lot of psychiatric questions because they are very direct, sometimes very crude. You know, do you have a, I mean, many times they come to you for a LASIK surgery and you ask them, do you have, you know, something so personal that they get really traumatized. So when they come in, they think that you're not a right person. But the take-home point from that case is, obsessive compulsive disorder is one of the major cause of people being unhappy with you for no reason. The second case is, we had this, I think Dr. Sanjay is not here. So he referred me a case from Bombay. This girl, similar, something very similar. And, but her problem is that her dryness is just not getting better. And they tried multiple drugs, she just come to us. And like, Professor Bellin said, a lot of drugs like selective serotonin retake uptake inhibitors have a direct impact on the dryness. So the question is, until unless we look at, and there is a lot of people who are actually on these drugs which we don't ask them. And probably this girl, we never asked that she was on this medications. For 3-4 years he was on this. So basically we're driving home a point here that all this science, clinics, cell biology and all is great, but the most important thing which makes you and your patients happy is actually the mind. And Vaitesh did some very interesting stuff. What he did was, we gave a questionnaire to all the patients who are undergoing, I think you helped him with the questionnaire. It's called a Big Five questionnaire, patient undergoing PRK or cross-linking. And when you looked at those questionnaire, at the end of it, we could actually evaluate. It just takes 5 minutes for him to fill up. It's not something too dramatic. It's just, so when you actually look at the patient's pain with Wong Baker score and you compare it with his personality, they're so bang on. That means your pain is not just your pain, it's also how you perceive pain. So what we start sometimes doing is, which I want to do, is that if you have a pre-op high level of some personality, you can explain in very shortly about what personality you felt were more having more pain than the other person.
So the questionnaire that we used was a Big Five. So it basically assessed the patient's personality in 5 aspects. One was extraversion, the openness, agreeableness, neuroticism, and conscientiousness. So basically what we found at the end of the analysis was, based on the preoperative scores of each of these personality parameters, we correlated it to their patient's Wong Baker scale of pain. So exactly what I found was extraversion score, which was less than 11, or an agreeableness score less than 11, and a neuroticism score which is more than 6. So if a patient fits into any of these parameters after filling up the questionnaire, which takes only 5 minutes, we know that the patient's Wong Baker score post-op is going to be more than 4, which is quite a lot of discomfort. So
that means, just to stop you here, that means if the patient is a more agreeable in nature and he is less of neurotic in nature and he is more introvert in nature, then your patients are going to have more trouble. It may look not necessary today, but if you really look at those in India, we have a lot of issues with doctors being abused and hit. It is all these people, because they don't reason when they actually abuse you, because that reasoning capacity in the mind has lost, because they don't reason. Now, when this guy comes and tells me this doctor is at fault, he has absolute lost the reasoning in himself. So when you do reason, they can even hit you, right? You must be seeing a lot in Nimans about this kind of people.
There are many ways of identifying the personality. Only by asking, there are no tests as such, scan or anything to pick up what kind of personality he is. One of the scale is that Big Five. Agreeableness is the people who can work under you very well, and they will listen to the doctors very well. Neuroticism are the people who worry a lot. Anything, small thing, again, they will come you. If you give their personal number, they will call you maybe 3 or 4 times a night. So these are the kind of people they have. You should always ask, are there any other medication that you are taking? Many people, when they seek a different under psychiatric treatment, they will never tell you that I'm undergoing a treatment for depression or for a psychosis. So you can indirectly ask, what medication are you on? So you see the list, you not have to hesitate and telling that you're on psychiatry or seeing psychiatrist, but you can know the side effects. That way you can go ahead, I think.
Dr. Parul?
So Rohit, coming to your previous question, the area of work where I work is Gurgaon, Delhi, which is very similar to the Western countries, and hence the rate of mental health issues are much more. I can identify a lot of kids who are being hyperactive in the OPD, and you know, you understand where they are coming from. So to answer your question, the moment I suggest that probably your child needs to see a psychiatrist, they will completely freak out. I mean, Indians still have a big, big taboo about mental health. Look at the way people responded when he said half of the people in West are on drugs. We laugh. If I say your half of the population is on thyroid, it's okay, it's thyroid problem. Insulin, diabetes, hypertension, we don't laugh. But a person with mental health disorders, if he's on antidepressant, anti-anxiety, we even doctors ridicule those patients. So first and foremost, we have to be sensitized to this mental health issue. It's not something which you can help. It doesn't make you small. And hence, when they come problem to you, it's not just an eye a problem. They have a baggage also. So what I do is a middle way, because I'm working in a multi-speciality hospital. The moment I say psychiatrist, it's not going to work out. They will not even come to me for their eye problem in future, you know, if I say psychiatrist. So I say probably he needs a bit of counseling. Probably you need to see a psychologist. And then I tell my psychologist staff, that becomes a buffer, so that, you know, they go, they talk more. I may not be able to give them that much of chair time. The psychologist comes as a buffer, and if he feels the need, then they refer him to the psychiatrist. So that's what I do in my practice.
Yeah. And sometimes...
I agree with you, madam. In Nimans, we have overcome this hurdle. but especially for children, teachers, we have trained the teachers. So they refer themselves to the psychiatry. And it's a myth that everyone who comes to psychiatry will be put on medication. No. Almost 80% of children not on any medication, they require counseling. And you are, I think this is a good suggestion, refer them to a psychologist. He will see if there is more, then he might give a referral to a psychiatrist. Otherwise, he can just say counsel there. Yes, sir.
I think basically that is one of the reasons we thought we'll just keep some few minutes today at the end to discuss about it, because the kind of patients we are getting today, at least those who are unhappy and who are every single one has something or the other which is missed or which is forgotten or ignored. The third case is, it's happened some time back. There's a lady who underwent LASIK somewhere in US, and she had come to me. That was the same time we got a mibography done, and we felt that it's a meibomian glands were abnormal. We thought it's a meibomian issue. And we started treating her with lipid flow and multiple other things. But she never improved. Then one day, I mean, it happened, one of my residents was with her. She was with the mentally challenged child. And when she came into my room, actually, when I was coming out, I saw her playing with that child with a Down syndrome, I guess. So when she came into my room, I asked her, how old is the child? And she started crying and all that. And after some time, she opened up saying that, my biggest problem is that my husband does not accept this child as his own, because he probably he has an obsessive compulsive disorder that, you know, I should have everything perfect. So he has just ignored that child, and she is she's like working hard to have two children and taking care of this. So when I referred this to a psychiatrist, I said that you need, because of so many changes, and she was blaming everything on her eye. And unfortunately for an ophthalmologist, there were so many other pathological things in her eyes. Like she did not have meibomian glands, she had dryness. So I kept thinking that it is the dryness which is making her having that what Sharon and Natasha just showed, nociceptive pain. Then I referred to a psychiatrist. I don't know, her diagnosis was panic attacks. And she was having panic attacks which was creating, and she needed some place where she had to vent out. And for her, she couldn't fight with her husband because she needed him. She couldn't fight with the child because she had to take care. And there was nobody else who could with whom she could reason out. So she put the complete emphasis on her eye. And she kept blaming that my life is messed up because of my eye and because of my LASIK. And add to this, she was treated in Moorfields. The surgery was done in Moorfields. She was a National Geographic photographer. She wrote a blog, How LASIK Kills a Carrier, and everything. When you started her on this anti-panic attack drugs, it took close to 8 or 9 months for her to stabilize. I think Fludac or one of them was given. And she's not completely all right, but I can see her reasoning now. And she now comes to me and tells me that the stress of my child is making me not get better, which she never used to say that. She never used to bring the issue of the child. She used to always say that the stress, I got the surgery done, that's why I'm unhappy, and that's why it's putting blame on this.
Yeah. Two things. Yeah. I wonder, how do we get so much time to talk with people and find out they need any psychological needs are there? Second thing is that it's a trick, it's a mind trick, that when you are facing a larger problem, when you are tense, you tend to focus on your bodily complaints. There's always a connection between the mind and the body. We are all unhappy to a certain extent. Some are very unhappy, some are little unhappy. And that always happens, that they focus on some bodily organs. Eyes are the one thing, the other will be like headache. Headache is also come. You already know that when daughter-in-law is married and then he's unhappy in this, she will get a headache. So these are the mind and body connection. That's the one thing I can say.
You have something?
Yeah, so just a couple of hours back, we were having coffee outside, and one of our good friends, he was talking about working in a corporate hospital. What they have is, in pediatric department, when the child is admitted more than 10 days, they send the parents to the counselor, and they start the counseling at that point of time. And that's very interesting. We, in spite of dealing with disorders where blindness would occur, where we may not be able to do anything, we seldom take help from a psychologist or psychiatrist and counsel them about that. So counseling for our patients where we cannot do much also we do not do, and which I think is an interesting thing we should think of that.
Absolutely, because the whole idea of this session, even though we are pretty late, is to bring the home the concept that do not, patients may not shy away meeting a psychiatrist. You are trying to be shy referring to a psychiatrist. Each, see, my way of looking at it is that find some fault of HBTC something and send them off. You may have a different way of doing it, but always have a psychiatrist in your practice. And I have one, I refer at least one or two major ones every week. And good thing about psychiatrists, which I really like, is every single time they do a session, they give you a call back. They tell you what is improving. The interesting part is this guy from Punjab, he says now he's not obsessed with his eye, now he's obsessed with spiritualism. He wants to, he's left, and he says this is very typical because they change from one thing to the other, right?
That's better, more adaptive one.
Yeah.
Rohit, can I? There was this one concern about that questionnaire that you were talking about. Most of our patients are pretty well studied and they all know what's happening in the world and all. So when they write such a questionnaire, when they write an answer to that, they're usually manipulating it so that
you should always make your partner to write it. I mean, the best way, sometimes I was asking, I write this, that if I ask me, I may write that I'm a most extrovert, I do not have any neurotic one. But when you, many years back, I did this experiment with my fellows, not this batch. I gave the questionnaire to one batch, and and you fill it up. And Ashwin Mohan did the study, and I gave the questionnaire to their friends. I said, you fill it up. And what the friends wrote about, say, her, I mean, it's not this batch, and what she wrote about herself was totally different. So that means that you can, even in spite of telling that don't sign, do not write anything on that, but still, that means what you said is right. But we tell the patient, this will help me to titrate the pain level and all that. So we give them a different GAN to that. So they make it a point to that they're right.
Maybe you can give it to all of us here, that questionnaire, and let's just...
We will try to do it tomorrow, let's see.
So Rohit, you know, it's been so interesting, but you know what I wanted to point out, like before it reaches the level that you have to actually refer off to a psychiatrist, this means you've probably already landed in soup with the patient, you've already operated the patient, mostly it'll be the refractive surgery patients, rarely it'll be something else, it'll be a cataract or something else, right? So I was just thinking that, you know, there are two things which probably will protect you from even reaching that stage. One could be if we could standardize a small questionnaire, like maybe, you know, you guys are doing so much stuff on that. We could come up with some kind of a refractive surgery brief, like 10 questions about, you know, something, and we could just, you know, do a study on it with, say, a couple of hundred doctors, I mean, some group of
doctors. That's his area of interest,
that's
making
one
questionnaire.
Thing. Second thing I feel is that one thing is that you could have that questionnaire come into you before you actually see the patient, quickly run through it and see any traits which stand out. Second thing I feel is that with so much rush of work, I think our refractive surgeons mostly rely upon what the counselor has already spoken, what the optometrist has spoken. Unless you take out those 5 or 10 minutes to speak to the patient yourself and try to judge why the patient has actually come to you, what is he looking for out of the surgery, what are his expectations, what is it that troubles him. So typically I actually talk, first question is that why do you want LASIK, what is the problem that you're having with your glasses or contacts, what are you looking to get out of it, what is your occupation. These are 5 or 6 questions, you know, and I can usually judge whether this patient is actually, you know, going to do well or not. And I think, you know, sometimes you pick up those subtle points which lead you further and then you can investigate further. Some of them come with very, very funny expectations, and those are the ones who are going to come back at you and probably have an underlying psychiatric disorder. So
it's a brilliant point. Can you help us doing that?
Brilliant.
Can you help us something which is very simple, where it is not really impinging on their privacy, but still they are more honest in giving out the answers?
Yeah. As Madam pointed out, this personality questionnaire, you will never know what is the reality actually, real person is. Is that just one medium? It may not even turn out to be true. As sir pointed out, it's right. I think this is the basic things that one has to follow. Ask him exactly what he's looking for, what his expectation is, and the background check and what kind of work he does.
Can you help us make a questionnaire which will help us in our OPD? At least the staff can fill up or somebody can fill up. Because friends, this is going to be the problem of the future. Not future, it is happening now.
Rohit, I'm sure I would just like to add up. I think we are looking at this part only as a refractive surgeon and cataract surgeon. No, what I'm saying is, you think about it. I mean, I had operated one Steven Johnson baby for amniotic membrane last week. And the parents are calling up every day, my child is, I mean, they seriously, parents require counseling there. So similarly, a trauma patient, similarly, somebody who has really bad problem, ophthalmic problem, they all require counseling. And we actually are not involving our practice along with the psychiatry or counseling. So anything which is serious, which cannot be rectified by us, even trauma and those things, I think we should involve counselors along with
absolutely.
Them.
I think I have to draw a difference between what is the good practice, and second point is that how to avoid a malpractice suit. So these are getting merged, so that I will not be able to answer this.
I know, but you know, there is no real differentiator here. See, the court cannot identify if this boy from Punjab, he goes to court and say that surgery was done to me and I'm not happy, the court will ask an expert opinion. He will only look at his pupil, which is 8 millimeter. The court will say that his pupil is 8 millimeter, the surgeon should have kept a zone of say 10, God knows whatever. So then he would have avoided it. You're finished. But that is a lawsuit one. But you, as a doctor or a psychiatrist or know that his pupil is big because this guy's on drugs. The judge is not going to ask you, are you on which kind of cocktail of drugs? His cocktail of drugs actually makes all these changes, and both of them have seen the patient. And now if I see his patient, and he was on all kinds of, even pilocarpine doesn't constrict his pupil. So that means that minute he stopped this, he started reasoning himself now. But now the problem is, I was speaking to psychiatrist Dr. Shobha today, she says now he's gone into spiritual mode. But that is okay, you can go to Himalaya so he doesn't disturb anybody, not get disturbed. Thank you, sir, for a wonderful session. And
thank you.
The take-home point from this is incorporate somehow psychiatry and psychology in your practice.